Hi, let's talk about the pelvic vasculature. So the gonads are supplied with blood by the gonadal arteries and drained of blood by the gonadal veins. And while the gonads are either within the pelvic cavity in the case of ovaries, or in the scrotum as part of the perineum as part of the testes, one might think a priori that the blood supply is coming and going to sources within the pelvis, but actually these sources are within the abdominal cavity. So as you may recall, the gonadal arteries are branches off of the abdominal aorta. We can see the origin of the right gonadal artery coming off there. Typically, they're coming off at about the level of L2. So we can see a renal vein, the left renal vein there. There is our trunk of the SMA there. And we know that this is approximately at the L1 level. We can also see the inferior mesenteric artery trunk there. That's at about the L3 level. The bifurcation of the abdominal aorta into the common iliacs is at about the L4 level. And so here is our approximately L2 origin of a gonadal artery. Now that artery we can trace down, it's crossing over the IVC there. We can also see the gonadal vein going into the IVC there. So these gonadal vessels are traveling down, and we can see them moving more laterally here. So they're going toward the deep inguinal ring. So that's the beginning of the inguinal canal, and that's how we would positively identify those as the testicular artery and vein. The ovarian artery and vein, if it's that variant of the gonadal artery, would be heading within the pelvis, within something called the infundibular pelvic or IP ligament, or the suspensory ligament of the ovary, and those vessels would be traveling down towards the ovary and back from the ovary. You can still refer to either the ovarian or the testicular artery and vein is the gonadal artery and vein, though. The language there is a little more broad and inclusive. So looking at a bigger picture here, we can see the bifurcation of the abdominal aorta, again, at about the L4 level. That's turning into the common iliac artery. So we can see the common iliac arteries there. And then within the pelvis, kind of adjacent to the brim of the pelvis, we can see the common iliac arteries bifurcate again into the external iliac artery. So there's the external and the internal iliac artery. The internal iliac artery is going to serve all of the pelvic viscera. It will also exit the pelvic cavity to attend to regions of the hip as well as the perineum. The external iliac artery is heading down towards the lower limb, and when it crosses over the inguinal ligament right there, we are going to refer to it as the femoral artery. And that femoral artery is going to continue to serve the lower limb as the dominant blood supply. Now the veins are of the same pattern. So we can see there's a femoral vein there, and it becomes the external iliac vein on the proximal portion or proximally to the inguinal ligament. And that will continue up, and it will join the internal iliac vein to form the common iliac vein. So here you can actually see the common iliac, and the bifurcation of those vessels is obscured, but we can see there's the inferior vena cava, and we can see the beginning of the bifurcation into the common iliac veins, and those will bifurcate into external and internal iliac veins, following the same pattern that that we've seen with the arteries, which is nice. Now, there is one branch of the external iliac artery that we've talked about previously. This has been in conjunction with the anterior abdominal wall, and let me just outline for us. There is the external iliac artery, and here is the femoral artery. This is the femoral artery in a region of the lower limb known as the femoral triangle, which we'll get into greater detail during MSK. And just before the transition, that external iliac artery is going to give rise to this vessel, which is the inferior epigastric artery. Now, let me go to green here. What you're seeing here is a reflection of the anterior abdominal wall, and that muscle there is the rectus abdominis muscle, running from the pubic bones up to the rib cage, and we can see the inferior epigastric artery winding its way into that that muscle. We can also see the inferior epigastric vein coming from the external iliac vein. We can see that here, draining that muscle. As we can see there. Those vessels are going to anastomose with superior epigastric arteries and veins, respectively. Those are coming down from the internal thoracic artery and vein. So the rectus abdominis has good collateral blood flow and drainage complements of these vessels. Now let's take a look at the branches of the internal iliac artery. For our convenience, we have pelvis here that represent sort of the extremes in what is typical of what one might call the female pelvis there and the male pelvis there, or hemipelvis. Let's give us a couple of landmarks to cling to. So right there is the pubic symphysis. We can see the pubic symphysis right there. I can also see the penis going off screen, and there's the urethra there. Urinary bladder is right there, so UB. Here is a very constricted urinary bladder here, a UB. Here are ejaculatory ducts right there, EJD, from the ductus deferens and the seminal vesicle there. These are all sitting atop what would be the prostate gland. Over here, this is the uterus. And there is the vagina. Here is the cervix. And then posteriorly, let me just outline this for us. There is the rectum and anal canal. And here is the rectum and anal canal. And let's take a look at some arteries. So let's go red here. So here we can see the common iliac artery heading down this way. That's common iliac, and it is going to bifurcate. There's the external, and here is the internal iliac. Over here we can see the same thing. There's the common iliac bifurcating into an internal and an external iliac. That internal iliac has both posterior and anterior divisions. So there's the posterior division there, iliolumbar and lateral sacrals and whatnot. And then here is that terminal branch of the posterior division, the superior gluteal artery. Over here we can see the same thing. There's our superior gluteal artery. That superior gluteal artery is exiting the pelvic cavity superior to the piriformis muscle, which we can see here in the background. This is a relationship that is preserved in the hip. Oops. So the superior gluteal artery entering the hip superior to the piriformis muscle. And then we have the anterior division. So that's the posterior. Here's the anterior division. We can see a very massive anterior division over here. And that is going to have a multitude of clinically important branches. So let's start with this lovely here. This is going to be the umbilical artery. We can see the umbilical artery over here, traveling along. And that umbilical artery is going out to the anterior body wall. And once it hits that anterior body wall, at least in any age beyond parturition or birth, it is going to be obliterated, and it will be the umbilical ligament. And that umbilical ligament is going to be found running in the anterior abdominal wall in a fold of peritoneum known as the medial umbilical fold, heading up towards the umbilicus. It's that umbilical artery that is going to supply branches down to the urinary bladder, called superior vesical branches. So it's very important that we see the targets of these arteries. So as they go to the bladder, they are superior vesical. You can see it's coming down like so. The next major branch, and it's kind of difficult to appreciate this because some of the vessels are in the way, but it's heading in the same general direction as the umbilical artery, but it's going to head towards the obturator canal. We can see that there. That is the here, it would continue on that way. That's the obturator artery. We can see that here. So this artery is going to pierce through the obturator internus and externus and head out toward the medial compartment of the thigh, where it serves those adductors of the thigh. The next branch over here that we can see, I'm just going to erase this. There's a common trunk here. This common trunk is bifurcating into what will be the uterine artery, just heading over this way to the uterus, and the vaginal artery, heading down towards the vagina. That uterine artery, if you recall, is going to run over the urethra. Here is the urethra descending down and see that it's crossing into the pelvis at the junction of the internal and external iliac arteries. There's the urethra over here. No uterine artery on this side because there's no uterus. But that's where we get our water under the bridge because the ureter is crossing under the uterine artery at the internal os of the cervix. So that's approximately there, but it's going to be obscured by the uterus. We also have middle rectal arteries. Here's the middle rectal artery supplying branches to the rectum. Here we can see the middle rectal artery. There's a nice inferior vesical branch to the urinary bladder there. And we have internal pudendal arteries. Which we can see there. The internal pudendal artery is going to exit out of the pelvis through the greater sciatic foramen, wrap around the sacrospinous ligament, head through the lesser sciatic foramen, and through the through the pudendal canal or Alcox canal, which is the fascia of obturator internus muscle, and go out to serve the perineum with blood. And then finally, we have the inferior gluteal artery. The inferior gluteal artery is going to exit out the pelvis to serve the hip, inferior to the piriformis muscle. And that's a relationship that we will see when we look at the blood supply to the hip joint and the muscles controlling the hip joint. So that is the review of the vasculature of the pelvis and the various branches and their targets. Thank you very much for your time.